श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः, सभाय नमः, सभासद्भ्यो नमः। नमस्ते एंड अ वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल आवर फ्रेंड्स। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ इंडिका योगा, टुडे वी आर ऑन द 20th डे ऑफ द ग्लोबल फेस्टिवल ऑफ योगा दैट्स बीइंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय इंडिका योगा अलोंग विद सेवरल पार्टनर्स एट द नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल लेवल। As you all know, Indica Yoga is a platform which offers diverse and inclusive forms of yoga focusing on authenticity, immersion, and transformation. And this morning, we have yet another great speaker and a researcher coming on to lead our session. I invite Jairaman ji to kindly join us on the screen. Namaste, Jairaman ji. स्वागतम।
Namaste.
I'm delighted and yet and honored to have Jairamanji as our speaker this morning. He will be presenting on a very important topic, the essence of yoga, life and teachings of Yogin Sadashiva Brahmendra. A brief formal introduction about Jairamanji. Jairaman Mahadevan is the director research at Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, Chennai. He holds a PhD for his research dissertation on the doctrine of Tantra Yukti from University of Madras. This is something that I would like to share a little more. Tantra Yukti is a specific approach to presentation of scientific or systematic data and subject in a particular manner. In fact, the way Jairamanji has developed it and been offering training programs on it as the Indian research methodology, taking cues from various traditional texts, he has developed all these and been presenting everywhere. And today he is one of the resource persons to deliver training programs on Indian research methodology. He works specifically in the areas of textual studies and research in yoga. He has to his credit 11 peer-reviewed papers and 12 books on textual aspects of yogas and Vedas. Maybe later I request him to tell us about the various books that he has written on yoga. He has traveled nationally and internationally to conduct workshops and present papers in conferences related to yoga, Sanskrit, and Indic research methodology. His special focus currently is to develop interactive methods to teach texts of yoga to facilitate an immersive learning experience. He is also one of the leading hands in coming up with a digital repository of yoga called Yoga Vaisharadi, of which I again request Jairamanji to speak a little later, a little more in detail, because that's one place where all the yoga aspirants can find various texts and teachings of yoga in one place. So with this formal introduction, I would also like to add a personal note. Jairamanji and myself, we studied together in Veda Vijnana Gurukulam. We had many, many years of companionship, and we still cherish the wonderful time that we had during our studies, during our examinations, the exchanges, and the learning that we had together. So with this brief introduction, I invite Jairamanji to take over, and I also welcome all our participants for this wonderful, wonderful session. Jairamanji, over to you. Your voice is muted.
Yeah. Namaste to all the participants from world over. And at the outset, I would like to thank Indic Academy, Vinay Chandraji, for this opportunity. Now, at the outset, I would like to start with a prayer. Yogena chittasya padena vacham malam sharirasya cha vaidyakena yopakarottam pravaram muninam patanjalim pranjaliranatosmi abahu purushakaram Shankha Chakrasi Dharinam Sahasra Shirasam Shvetam Pranamami Patanjalim Shri Krishna Vagisha Yatishvarabhyam Samprapta Chakrankana Bhashya Saram Shrinutnarangendrayatau samarpitaswam Shri Krishnamaryam Guruvaryamide Virodhe Kartike Mase Shatatara Krutodayam Yogacharyam Krishnamaryam Guruvar Yamaham Bhaje Krishna Suri Daya Patram Jnana Vairagya Bhushanam श्रीमद् वेङ्कटनाथार्यं वन्देहं योगदेशिकम् श्री नमः हरिः ॐ ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः one and all. I once again thank the organizers for the opportunity to share my thoughts on the topic, the essence of yoga based on the life and teachings of Sri Sadashiva Brahmendra, who was a great yogindra of the 18th century. A couple of words about Sri Sadashiva Brahmendra as an introduction before we go into the topic as such. Sri Sadashiva Brahmendra was a great yogin who was an avadhuta. That means the one who has, one who was an embodiment of renunciation of the very highest level. So he was an avadhuta parivrajaka. And he lived in Tamil Nadu, in the Kumbakonam, Tanjavur region, in 17th and 18th century. So, it's about him, it is about his life, and it is about the teachings that he has left. So, based on which, this lecture or this talk, in this talk, I would like to share just how we can recenter, recalibrate suggestions. These are suggestions as to how we can recenter, recalibrate our current perception about yoga. So this is the brief introduction. So now we will get into the talk as such. I propose to present my thoughts in three parts. Now, what is the current perception about yoga? That is, what is the essence of yoga? As to what is central to yoga? So about that, we will spend a few moments. And then, by looking at the life of Yogi Sri Sadashiva Brahmendra, what do we see as represented as the core or the center of yoga or the dimensions of yoga? Not only from the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra, but also from the teachings of the great yogin, the great acharya, as to what is important, what is core, what is central to yoga. So we will start from where we are now. From the now, we will start. We are all here to celebrate, are part of this global yoga festival, and that we know has its roots in the announcement of June 21 as the International Day of Yoga by the United Nations. It was a resolution. You see a copy of the resolution on the screen. So it's based on this that we have the current celebration, or we are all together because of this. And it was a resolution historically, which was proposed by 170 nations together. And what does this document say about yoga? How yoga is very important to humanity? What does it say? It says that yoga is very important. This International Day of Yoga, which is to create awareness of about yoga. So why should awareness be created about yoga? Because the document says, that it's very effective in tackling NCDs, non-communicable diseases. And it also says that it's a very healthy lifestyle practice. And it's all it, the document also mentions that it's a holistic approach to health. And now in the current era of this pandemic, Corona, we also understand experientially that yoga increases immunity, and it is also a very strong firewall against even the deadly communicable disease that is Corona. So thus we see that this is the context in which we are together, and this also represents the global perception about yoga, the current perception. And this is also well documented. See, these are not when it is in the global level. We also know there is a mounting level of evidence about the various benefits of yoga. It's very systematically documented, very various health benefits at the level of at the physical level. It has implications, positive influence on the heart rate, respiratory rate, cardiovascular efficiency, musculoskeletal flexibility, weight, sleep, immunity. All these are pain. All these are favorably influenced by the practice of yoga. And not even at the merely at the level of the body, even at the level of mind, we see various psychological benefits of yoga, like subjective well-being, self-acceptance, self-actualization, increase in anxiety, psychomotor functions, depth perception, and whatnot. So every dimension of physical and mental health we speak, we see that yoga has a very, very positive influence these days. And this also drives the current perception about yoga. And is this the current perception? What do the texts say about it? Yes, the texts also testify. The ancient, the traditional classical yoga texts, they also testify to the health benefits of yoga. For example, we see in the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, towards the end of the second chapter, a host of health benefits are mentioned. Vapuh krishatvam, vadane prasannata, nadasphutatvam, nayane sunirmale, arogata, vindujayaha, agnidipanam, nadi vishuddhihi, hatha siddhi lakshanam. Slimness of the body, freshness in face, clarity of voice, eyes are clear, freedom from illness, which indicates immunity, control of sensual desires, stimulation of digestive fire, and purity of the nadi. So it's not only the current perception, but even the texts also present this health, well-being dimension of yoga, which arises out of the asana pranayama practice, because this appears at the end of the second chapter of Hatha Yoga Pradipika, where asana and pranayama sections, they conclude. So, and when we see this, it is also the universality of yoga. Also, we can see, again, the texts say that yuva vriddhoti vriddhova vyadhitaha durbalopiva abhyasat siddhimapnoti sarvayogeshvatandritaha. So, youth, old, very old, afflicted by disease, weak, anyone and everyone, by the practice, abhyasat siddhimapnoti sarvayogeshu atandritaha. So yoga is for all, and yoga is, or yoga caters to the physical and physiological well-being. So all that is well documented, and this is the narrative, or this sums up the current perception and practice about what is central to yoga in these current times that which we are living in. Now the next question is this the essence of yoga, or is this the sum total of yoga? When we ask this, and is this the reason why yoga exists, and is there anything else beyond in the field of yoga? So these are the few questions that come to our mind when we look into the current perception of yoga. Now, when I ask this question, it is not to establish that all that we are doing from the health and well-being perspective, all this is fault and what we currently understand is wrong. No, this is not the objective of this talk. This is to present a wider canvas or wider or the just to show how the boundaries of yoga are much more wider. Of course, health well-being perspective is very important. That's very central to yoga to start with, but it doesn't end there. There are wider and wider, deeper and higher dimensions to yoga. So this talk proposes to only gently point the index finger in that direction. So whatever discussion that is now henceforth done after in this talk is just to point to those higher, unexplored, less explored dimensions. So which gives a broader perspective. It might even give a greater purpose to yoga, and the approach to yoga may also change, and the solutions for problem, most of those who are part of our listeners may be already very experienced practitioners of yoga. When we look it from the current level, we may be grappling with various aspects of yoga, but when we see the higher, or when we raise to the higher podium, as in Vyasa Bhashya, we see Prajna Prasadam Aruhya Ashochyaha Shochato Janan Bhumishthaniva Shailasthaha Sarvam Prajnyonu Pashyati. So as if getting or climbing onto a higher plane and looking at things may put things in a better perspective, or it may help us understand things in a better way. So what are the higher dimensions of yoga, or what are the other dimensions of yoga beyond the body and the mind? So this is what is currently being attempted to just place humbly before you. Now, what is the basis? How are we going to do it? All this is available in all the textual literature. What is the higher and deeper purpose of yoga beyond health and well-being? Swasthya, beyond that, there are higher aspects. We know all, everyone is aware of it. But still, to effectively feel that, we human beings, we need solid, tangible persons who have led the life in that manner. More than the texts, it is the lives that impact us more. So we are all driven by the idea of role models. Even in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, Utsideyurime lokaha nakuryam karma chedaham. So I am being watched, or Krishna says that everyone, all the jivatmans, they look up to me. So hence I have to lead a proper way of life. So I have to do karma. So that idea is there. So human beings, we always look at solid models, role models. And there is a famous statement in Sanskrit, which also means Mahajano yena gatasya panthaha. So the path that is taken by the respected people, so that we have a natural tendency to follow. So even the Yoga Sutras say that Vita Raga Vishayam Va Chittam. The very first chapter, we see that how to attain a state of Manah Prasadaha, a very pleasant, calm, anxiety-free state of mind. Look at the Vita Ragas. Look at the people who have overcome passion, desire, who are embodiments of detachment and from worldly afflictions. So look at them, then we will get inspiration and guidance. So it is also a yogic activity. What we are doing now, to look into the lives of great yogis like Sadashiva Brahmendra, is also a yogic activity, as testified or as presented, as taught by sage Patanjali himself, to widen the understanding about the purpose of yoga. There were very great yogins, very inspirational yogins in the past. The one has to study the life of sage Vishwamitra in the Ramayana. How many attempts to refine, how many attempts to transform, how many attempts to transcend from the level he was in. So really a great inspirational yogi, even Shuka in the Bhagavata Puranam. So all these are great yogins of the past. Again, more than the yore or more than the past, we need closer to contemporary time examples, and that example which we propose to look into is the life of sage Sadashiva Brahmendra. So as I mentioned at the very opening, he was a great yogin born in the South India, and his date or year of birth is not very clear, but there are accounts that point to his year of Mahasamadhi, the great when he attained the liberation. So that Siddhi, so that date is available. So he lived to a safe extent, we can say he lived till 1756. So from this point of view, so what is the higher purpose and deeper dimensions of yoga? So what do we see from his life and teachings? So that we will look into now. He led a very extraordinary life. Sadashiva Brahmendra led an extraordinary life. And in most of the yoga teachers training programs that we do, one chapter that we skip is the third chapter, the Vibhuti Yoga. But Sadashiva Brahmendra's life is full of examples from that chapter. So Vibhuti is higher powers that are attained through yoga. It is always in our current study of yoga, we leave that chapter because currently it is not so relevant. That's how it is presented. But we see in the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra, he lived as an example for any example any sutra from the third chapter you see, you can see an instance. I'm just from the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra. For example, there is an anecdote. All these are documented in the 1911 edition of Sadashiva Brahmendra's, it's published by Vani Vilas Press. In the 1911 edition, there are mentions about the great deeds or siddhis of Sadashiva Brahmendra, of his work. His work, Yoga Sudhakara, is published by the Vani Vilas Press in 1911. There, some of these great deeds of Sadashiva Brahmendra is printed or documented. So we see that he was carried away by flood in Kaveri River. But later, then he just, after he is deposited in one place, carried by the flood, then he simply walks away from there as if nothing has happened. So this is an example of sthula swarupa sukshma anvaya arthavatva sanyamat bhuta jayaha, control over the elements. So the water could not do anything, but it was just a vehicle for him. Though it was flood in Kaveri, he was not affected by it. So this is a higher possibility in yoga which Sadashiva Brahmendra displayed in his life, or he lived with those higher potentials in yoga. Then we see that he was an avadhuta. He was detached and he was walking through, and there was the tent of a nawab built in the banks of a river. He simply walked in through that. So the nawab was angry, and then he took his sword and cut the arms of Sadashiva Brahmendra. As if nothing has happened, Sadashiva Brahmendra kept walking. And later, the person understood that he is a great soul, and then saluted Sadashiva Brahmendra, and only then Sadashiva Brahmendra realized that his limbs are cut. So when he touched, naturally the arms got rejoined. To this, there is a very insightful verse in the Yoga Vasishtha. Shamamrita rasachannam mano yameti nirvritim chinnanyapi tayangani manye rohanti raghava. So it's a teaching by Vasishtha to Rama, where he says, the mind which is fully occupied or fully covered by the amrita, the nectar-like quality of shama, shama amrita rasa achannam, the mind which is fully soaked in the quality of turning inwards and calm and inner peace. What is this? This is called as antashitalata in Yoga Vasishtha. That is wetness or wetness in the heart or coolness in the heart. So a heart or a mind which is absolutely cool by the quality of shama, even if the limbs are severed, they again come back. So a mind which is perfectly in a state of higher poise, all these physical discomforts, they will not bother. Rather, these discomforts, they get rectified on their own. So this is another example. And then we also see in the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra that he was seen in many places in the same time, corroborated by so many people. Again, this is another teaching from the third chapter, where we see Nirmana Chittani Asmita Matra. A yogi, by his yogic powers, he can create so many minds and so many bodies in various places. So this again is lived out, or this Yoga Sutra finds its expression in the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra. And so many such further life events show what are the higher possibilities from yoga, which are normally not touched in our current day study. We say that, hindrances, obstacles. Emphasis is lot of emphasis is on the obstacle nature. So, te samadhau upasargaha vyutthane siddhayaha. That sutra is often quoted, that all these siddhis are obstacles towards the path of samadhi, and only when for world outside, these are kind of siddhis or great powers. So we say that these are not to be focused upon. This is the current justification given to skipping this chapter. But when we study deeper about, or when we reflect upon this chapter, this actually portrays the tremendous strength of the human mind. So when the mind is cultured, refined, strengthened by all the yogic practices, by deepening the yoga practices, the mind gains tremendous powers by which all that which are not possible in the normal sense become possible. These are the higher potential. Maybe this has to be presented in this angle. In Yoga Sutra, the concept of Chitta Bala, especially in the Vyasa's commentary, is given towards the end or the fourth chapter. We see Jnana Vairagye Kena Atishayyete. By strengthening the mind by knowledge and also detachment and dispassion, unparalleled powers are achieved. Two examples are given from Vyasa Bhashya. Dandakaranyam cha chitta balavyatirekena kaha sharirena karmana shunyam kartum utsaheta. the commentators clarify that Vyasa says that the Shukracharya was a personality in the Puranas that we see. So he is said to have burnt the entire Dandakaranya. So Vyasa asks, can burning of an entire forest happen merely physically? No, it can happen only by the Chitta Bala, the strength of the tremendous strength of the mind that Shukracharya had attained. By that, he could do this feat, which cannot be done only by physical endeavors. And Samudram Agastya Vadva Pibet. We also listen to a mythological account or story in the Purana where Agastya, a sage, drank the entire ocean for a certain purpose. So, this is taken by Vyasa to indicate that Chitta Balam, this concept of Chitta Balam is not emphasized these days. So, by developing or by charging the Chitta with great strength through Jnana and Vairagya, all these seemingly impossible feats are possible. Now, this doesn't mean that everyone should fly in the sky, walk on the water, walk through the walls, etc. The point that I am trying to make is that yoga can help humanity by strengthening the mind a lot. Probably this chapter of Vibhuti Pada, the third chapter of Yoga Sutras, as we see from the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra, can be presented to show the very high possibilities of human beings if their mind is strengthened. If yoga is advocated merely as an alternative, a complementary therapy to overcome certain illnesses and weaknesses, okay, it of course serves the purpose. But if this higher, greater possibility of strengthening the mind to a very great extent, if that is presented, so in English we say, aim at the star and shoot at the sky. So when these higher aims can be presented, at least progress to a greater level is possible. When the higher possibilities are portrayed, or we can see from the lives of great people, that the level of motivation to practice yoga will be increased. As I belong to Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, where we see so many people walking in for various therapeutic needs. Yes, of course, they practice yoga, but one recurring problem that we have seen is motivation. So only when a systematic practice of yoga is done, that any problem of physical or psychological issues, they can be overcome. So regularity of practice is driven by motivation. So rather than presenting yoga as overcoming certain illnesses and difficulties, if these higher potentials or the higher possibilities of yoga is discussed more, then a desire and a motivation towards achieving those higher goals will be better, and the current level of practice will be raised to a great extent. So that is the higher potential that this dimension of Sadashiva Brahmendra's life presents. And now when I discuss these siddhis, do I mean to say that these are the highest possible goals or potentials that are achieved through yoga? No, I don't mean it. I don't say that these are the greatest possible potentials that are to be achieved through yoga. the greatest of all human potential that is to be achieved through yoga is stated right in the outset of Yoga Sutras. Tada drashtuhu swarupe avasthanam, being established in the pure conscious nature. So that is the greatest of the potentials that is to be achieved through yoga. Even in the Bhagavata Purana, we see that there is a beautiful description where the creator fashions out so many kinds of beings. Prikshan, Sari, Sripa, Pashun, Khaga, Damsha, Matsyan. So the creator creates the trees. He creates the reptiles. He creates the insects. He creates the quadrupeds, animals that walk on four legs. He creates so many kinds of beings, but he is not yet fully satisfied with his creation. But when he finally creates human beings who are able to realize their pure conscious nature, Brahmavaloka Dhishanam, when human beings are created who can realize their pure conscious nature, now the creator is satisfied. So the greatest of human potential is realization of the true conscious nature. And this is not, it's again not a state which is a dull state. Realizing or being established in the pure conscious state is not a dull state. Sadashiva Brahmendra, who has written so many texts, in his text Atma Vidya Vilasa, beautifully presents what is Swarupe Avasthanam. So what is Swarupe Avasthanam? It is blissful existence. How do blissful people live their lives? Tishthan Paratra Dhamni Sviya Sukhasvada Paravashah Kaschit. Tishthan Paratra Dhamni Sviya Sukhasvada Paravashah Kaschit. Kvapi Dhyayati Kuhachit Gayati Kutrapi Nrityati Swairam. Fully engrossed in the enjoyment of his own conscious nature, that is the bliss, as strikes his fancy, here he is engaged in thought, there he is singing, and there he is dancing in ecstasy. So this is a Swarupe Avasthanam. And who better can express it in such a blissful manner other than Sadashiva Brahmendra? So this is living blissfully, being established in the true nature. Not only that, so the highest potential of yoga, highest thing that we can reach through yoga is this state of absolute bliss is what we can reach while living. And as we see in the Raghuvamsha, Kalidasa, the great Sanskrit poet says, Yogena ante tanutyajam. By the practice of yoga, leaving or shedding this frame at will, living blissfully, unconcerned, without any anxiety, without any worry, dancing and singing in blissful ecstasy, and then whenever it is time, departing at will, not suffering in the hospital beds in the last time, but shedding this mortal frame and then leaving for higher state. So this summarizes. So living blissfully and departing at will, this is what Sadashiva Brahmendra did. He has not only spoken about it, he lived. And is this not the ultimate goal of every human life? Is this not the highest swasthya? We speak about swasthya, being established in the true self. Does this not summarize where yoga should lead us? So it's absolute immersion in bliss, freedom from afflictions, concerns, anxieties, worries, and shedding the frame at will through yoga. The very picture of Sadashiva Brahmendra indicates that no human norms restrict him. He is an avadhuta. So such a highest possible potential can be achieved through yoga. So we started out at the level of yoga being a tool for therapy. Then we see greater sensory mental potentials of the mind can be unraveled through yoga. When we emphasize on the point of chitta balam, the mind has to be strengthened. And after that, there is a state which can be achieved through yoga where the mind is transcended. See, as long as the mind bothers us, these words, concern, anxiety, worry, have any relevance. If the mind itself is transcended, it's only pure bliss. That is also the highest potential through yoga that can be achieved. So this is what I intended to present. That is to open up the widest possibilities. Our objective or our practice in yoga can be more meaningful, can have a higher or kind of a longer goal or a much more upper kind of higher goal in our life. So how did he do this, or how did Sadashiva Brahmendra achieve this state? Whenever we speak in our discussions, when we see when there are possibilities, the question of how of it should also be addressed. Unless we address the how of it, then speaking of mere higher potentials will be of not much use. So we see that I'm just going to present 3 points. So high sensitivity to worldly sufferings. Dukkhameva sarvam vivekinaha. Sutra 2.15 says that being sensitive about the worldly happenings and how they are imbued with suffering. So that should be a great aspect to be noted to move to those higher dimensions of yoga. The Vyasa Bhashya says, Akshipatra kalpohi vidvaniti. Yatha urna tantuhu akshipatre nyastaha sparshena dukkhayati nacha anyeshu gatra vayaveshu. A small strand of the cobweb, if it falls on the skin, on the hand, will it make any impact? No. But if the same thin strand of web, cobweb, that falls on the eyes, then what happens? The eyes are reddened, there is water flowing from it and highly disturbed. So vidwan or a yogi is like an akshipatra. He is highly sensitive. He is watching everything as to how they lead to suffering. So that highest level of sensitivity to worldly happenings and their final outcome. So that is essential. We see this in the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra when in his, after he was married and then after his studies are over, he comes back to his home and there was a great ceremony being organized. So there Sadashiva Brahmendra was extremely hungry. And because of that, he was suffering. But everyone is at the house, everyone is involved in various, they were talking with each other, there was clamor and they were discussing among themselves. But this boy, Sadashiva Brahmendra, was not noted. So Sadashiva Brahmendra, as a very sensitive soul, he absorbed this. The gathering there, the clamor there represented to him the worldly life and then his own personal suffering of hunger, extreme hunger. So that kind of sparked that how this worldly involvement will lead to suffering. And then and there he leaves home and then goes in search of a great guru, Paramashivendra Saraswati. And then initial spark, yes, everyone might get, but are we able to maintain the intensity of the intent? So that is the second point. Are we able to nurture that spark into a great flame? That is indicated by the intensity of intent. Even in Yoga Sutra, we see Tivra Samveganam Asannaha, those with very high intensity or intensity of intent, they succeed. To them, Samadhi is closer, Asannaha. Again, there is an anecdote from Sadashiva Brahmendra's life where we see that after leaving his house, he goes to Paramashivendra Saraswati, his teacher, and there he is with the guru. What happens is many people come to meet his guru, Paramashivendra Saraswati. So Sadashiva Brahmendra engages them in a shastric debate and discussion. So most of them, they are unable to answer logical questions and answer questions that are put, arguments that are put by Sadashiva Brahmendra. So they in a way feel very in a state of discomfort. So they go and complain to Paramashivendra Saraswati. This person, this boy, Sadashiva Brahmendra, is doing such things. So Paramashivendra Saraswati, the guru, calls Sadashiva Brahmendra and tells him, you are shutting others' mouth. When are you going to shut your mouth? This is the single statement that the guru says. And then without shutting the mouth, you cannot aspire to achieve all that you wanted to achieve. As to why you came to me. This one statement was enough for Sadashiva Brahmendra. And then he took a lifelong Maunavrata. He decided then and there that I will stop speaking. So if I have to turn inwards, then these verbal transactions are not going to help me much. So this is Tivra Samvega. And he kept it lifelong. He was a lifelong Maunavrati. And then because of this, he raised to a very great extent in his life, where finally even the guru in a way envied him. So Sadashiva Brahmendra, after his life transforming decision of Maunavrata, he rapidly progresses in his life and becomes an Avadhuta. Again, people go and complain. So people always keep complaining. So he talks a lot, people go and complain. Then again, carefree, in an unconcerned manner, Sadashiva Brahmendra is roaming about in various places. So again, people go and say to the teacher that Unmattavat Sancharatiha Shishyaha Taveti Lokasya Vachamsi Shrunvan Khidyannu Vachasya Guruh Puraho Unmattatame Nahi Tadrishiti. So people go and say that your disciple is roaming around on the streets and roads and villages as a madman. But when it's not actually an envy, it is the guru says that on hearing this kind of words from people, the guru says that, is he really roaming around like that? I feel when such madness will come to me. Unmattatame nahi tadrishiti. I'm not mad in that, like Sadashiva Brahmendra. Mad to the outer world, but firmly established in the blissful true nature internally. That the guru understands. And he says, when will I achieve that inner poise by which the external actions do not matter? So such was the level to which Sadashiva Brahmendra could raise because of the intensity of intent. So high sensitivity and then intensity of intent. And a final anecdote is from Sadashiva Brahmendra's life, is that even when he had reached such a higher state, there is possibility of failure, and there should be humility to learn from that state also. So once Sadashiva Brahmendra is lying on a harvested field. So the field was harvested, and then the leftover portion from the plants will be jutting out, and they will also be dry because of the sun of South India, the tropical sun. So Sadashiva Brahmendra is lying on open ground, open harvested field, and he is lying down there. Now what's happening there? He is having the bund. Bund means two segments of the field is divided by a raised mud kind of platform. So he is having that as his pillow, and then rest of his body is there lying on the field. So he is lying like that. Then what happens is couple of villagers, they pass through and look at Sadashiva Brahmendra, and they say that he is Sadashiva Brahmendra, the great realized soul. Though he is realized, but why does he need a pillow to lie down? Oh, he also needs certain comfort. Though they don't notice that he is lying on an open harvested field with sharp kind of particles sticking out from the ground, and his pillow is not any other soft cushion or something like that. It's just the bund on the field, but still they comment it this way. Then, and they comment and go, those two villagers pass. And then when they come back, we see that again Sadashiva Brahmendra has moved entirely into the field. Even his head is, he doesn't have the pillow for, or the bund as his pillow also. So there he still observes, yes, so this is a mistake, and then I have to forego comforts at whatever level. So that was relatively no comfort at all from our perspective, but even at that level he was very careful. He doesn't say, oh, who are these people to say about me? So I am a renounced soul, an avadhuta. He doesn't think that way. He respects and then moves entirely, lays his body entirely into the field, removing that pillow for the support. We see that in the third chapter of Yoga Sutra, sthan yupanimantrane sangasmaya karanam punar anishta prasangat. So this points out to the highest level of care that a yogi need to have while progressing to those higher levels, so that further slippage is avoided. So in this way, we see that Sadashiva Brahmendra lived blissfully and also inspired a lot of people, showcasing the higher potentials, especially the Sringeri Matha. Sringeri Matha is a very important place of religious and spiritual guidance people get from it, which has thousands of years of history. So great acharyas, the 32nd and 33rd gurus, took up Sadashiva Brahmendra as their role models, and they shaped their lives. So do I have time, or should I stop here?
In fact, I was thinking of taking that as a question to you next, to share a few things about Yoga Sudhakara and its importance.
Okay. Yeah. So I'll stop here. So the point I was trying to make is that yes, health, healing, well-being, and there is higher dimensions of well-being that we see from the life of Acharya Sadashiva Brahmendra. Yes, I conclude my talk here, and yeah, open to questions.
Thank you, Jairamanji, for actually highlighting something that is extremely important at this point of time. I was mentioning this yesterday. I'll also repeat. people with 200 hour program just reading sporadically here and there, and they start to call themselves as a yogi. The yogi title seems to be available very easily nowadays. But to look into the lives of people like Sadashiva Brahmendra or many such masters, we understand how much weight that word carries. And your presentation brought out in a very thorough manner, in a scholarly manner, as to what it implies to be a yogi with the life and teachings of Sadashiva Brahmendraji. So I think, thank you very much for this presentation. It adds a lot of value into what we are exploring through this entire month-long deliberations. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Should I add a couple of words?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So from the teachings of Sadashiva Brahmendra, I'll just add one just example. I have a lot to cover, unfortunately. Yeah. So this point, urgency in yoga, as you rightly mentioned. So urgency in yoga, short term, even in the research realm also, there are short term interventions and then there is benefits out of it. So out of short term interventions, benefits come. And when the benefit the participant experiences, then the practice also drops away. But yoga is far beyond it. There are higher potentials to yoga, just as we saw. So there is a term called Dirghakala dimension to Abhyasa. To that, Sadashiva Brahmendra says, he note that he adds in his Yoga Sutra commentary, Yoga Sudhakara, he says that it's a kind of a comical comment that he mentions, Vidyamanaha Chatvaraha Eva Vedaha Tan Adhyetum Gatasya Manavakasya Panchadina Panchadivasaha Atitaha Nadhyapi Asau Samagataha. See, there are only four Vedas. It is as if someone expects outcome of yoga in a very short time, how will it be like? He says, there are only four Vedas. See, only four Vedas. Rigveda, Yajurveda, Samaveda and Atharva Veda. So my child who went to study the Vedas, he has gone. He went some 5 days ago. So it's 5 days have gone past and he has not yet come back. See, there are only four Vedas. You know, everyone is aware that how vast the Vedic literature is. But merely looking at the four Vedas to be mastered in 4 days and expecting the child to return on the fifth day as a Chaturvedi, as it will become a very aspect of a laughing thing. Similarly, expecting short-term kind of thing is, it is possible. At a physical level, it is possible. A symptomatic relief is possible. But yoga is not concerned merely at the level of symptomatic level. It goes into heya, heya, hetu. So it goes till the heya, hetu and tries to solve the problems. And the last point is that there is a beautiful verse in Bhagavad Gita where we see Yavanartha Udapane Sarvatas Samplutodake Tavan Sarveshu Vedeshu Brahmanasya Vijanataha. See, all the benefits that we can derive from a well, they can very well be achieved in a very brimming reservoir, which is a great flood of water. So our normal kind of our times present yoga as a kind of source of water from that. Whereas when what we see from the lives of great yogis like Sadashiva Brahmendra is yoga is a vast ocean that has great potentials. It will help us carry us across the worldly sufferings also. So such is the potential of yoga. And I thank Indic Academy for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts on this.
Thank you. Just you mentioned it, I want to bring it to the forefront. Sadashiva Brahmendraji has also written a commentary that you were referring to, the Yoga Sudhakara. and being himself a yogi of that highest order, and his commentary to the Yoga Sutras would be very, very insightful. Maybe you'd want to share a couple of words on that. How is it special and how it will help us to understand Yoga Sutra much better? Any thoughts and comments
yes.
on that?
So actually I had a selection of points from Yoga Sudhakara. The one important, very phenomenal insight that he gives is, when we look into Yoga Sutras or even the tools of yoga, we see that in Yoga Sutra, there is a discussion about Abhyasa Vairagya, Kriya Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, all that. There are innumerable tools of yoga that is presented in the Yoga Sutras. In his commentary to the text, he beautifully organizes these tools. So he says that Abhyasa Vairagya is for a Samahita Chitta. So only the going by the definition of Abhyasa Vairagya as given in the Yoga Sutra, who is the Adhikari or who can only use the couple of tools of Abhyasa Vairagya, Samahita Chitta, a person whose mind is really relatively calm or unconcerned or not troubled by the concerns of the world. And Kriya Yoga is for a Vyutthita Chitta. So here you see two tools. Here the tools are more for a Vyutthita Chitta, a person with a distracted, a mind which has a tendency to go outwards. So the tools proliferate. And when we come to Ashtanga Yoga, Tatopi Vyutthita Chitta. So a person whose mind is more restless and in the highest great rajas is influencing his mind, he can start with Ashtanga Yoga. So the point is the clarity as to which tool belongs to me or where I am. So yoga is not, as even Krishnamacharya would put it, that yoga has to be understood as it applies to an individual. So not as it has been prescribed in the text. The texts prescribe a lot of things. A lot of options are available. We as a conscious individual should evaluate not only the what kind of teaching is being offered, we should evaluate ourselves, what really is expected. It is not that someone else is doing some kind of yoga. It may be power yoga, Ashtanga yoga, flow yoga, but what exactly is needed for me? So that a yogi or an aspiring practitioner of yoga should reflect. So that is the key teaching that we can see, that a yogi should or a aspiring practitioner of yoga should think for himself as to where I am and what my goals are. Only then the journey in yoga will be comfortable. And these and he is a great in his Yoga Sudhakara, we see he repeatedly quotes from Yoga Vasishtha. He has a preference to Yoga Vasishtha. So very powerful quotations from Yoga Vasishtha are appropriately juxtaposed by Sadashiva Brahmendra in his commentary. So again, another point about the current day yoga is body centricity. So the asanas or all these practices, of course, they are needed as a stepping stone, but body sculpting and other such practices are there. So when through yoga, when we are trying to transcend the limitations, so body centricity is brought by, unfortunately, by certain practices, certain trends in yoga, and it even degenerates into beer yoga and other things. So body centricity, it's a problem because it has further degenerating effect. So which aspect needs to be emphasized here is Vairagya is an aspect which we seldom discuss in the yoga classes and things. There he gives a very powerful, blunt, direct quotation from Yoga Vasishtha in the context of Sutra 2.40. He says, where to start from to develop Vairagya? He says, he quotes from Yoga Vasishtha and says, Swadeha Ashuchi Gandhena Na Virajyeta Yaha Puman Viraga Karanam Tasya nakinchid upalabhyate. If one does not see how one's own body emits a foul smell, so that is the starting point. See, we all, even in Sanskrita literature, we see sarvaha khalu kantam atmanam pashyati. Everyone would want to see themselves in the mirror as Mr. World or Miss Universe. So that's a great thing. But in the path of yoga, what we need to do is we have to transcend this, for that this starting point is vairagya, and vairagya can start directly from the body itself. So asanas are needed to refine the body, but it should not make us body centric. Towards that, this quotation from Yoga Sudhakara is very powerful reminder to that end. And there are so many other further wonderful aspects from Yoga Sudhakara we see that. So does this perspective, one final point that I would like to make and conclude, when we speak of these higher dimensions of yoga beyond health and well-being, does that neglect disease and illness in the body? There is a to the sutra on Ekatattva Abhyasa, Vyasa, Sadashiva Brahmendra again brings in a quotation from Yoga Vasishta, where when we see yoga from a higher kind of towards, when we look at yoga towards taking us to higher states, like the higher potentials, maybe it is the vibhutis or swarupe avasthanam, what is the role of disease? How can disease be managed in that state? To that we see, vasana samparityagehi yadi yatnam karoshyalam tatte shithilatam yanti sarva adhi vyadhayah kshanat. So the point is, sarva adhi and vyadhi, all diseases of the body and all the illnesses of the mind can be overcome if we focus on overcoming vasanas. Vasana samparityaga should be the focus. So when we work with, so how to do it, how to practically bring it in our day-to-day asana, pranayama practices, the goal, if we set it to a higher thing, that is the goal of asana or goal of pranayama, it is the same tools, but it is the way we look at it. Asana and pranayama are not to relieve some backache or some breathing trouble. Asana and pranayama have a transforming role at the level of vasanas. The earlier unrefined kind of, or not so mindful way of living, so those vasanas are being replaced or by the mindful prayatna, and the vasanas or the aklishta vasanas that are being stored. So when we move to this perspective of vasana changing potential of asana, pranayama, etc., when we look at that, then all these body centric kind of troubles, all that, they can be overcome in a better manner. So if the goal is higher, these lower issues may not bother us. So yeah, so this is the approach, and yeah, I would like to conclude here.
Thank you, Jairamanji, because this also answered a couple of questions that were there in understanding the role of asana or many other practices, even for the primary purposes of health and wellness. So you reconcile both. When the higher purpose is kept in mind, even the initial purposes are also achieved. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Just before taking up a couple of questions from our learned audience, they have asked very wonderful questions. I'd like to ask you, Sadashiva Brahmendra was a Brahmajnani on one side, a yogi, and he was also a composer. Like, he has composed such beautiful songs of the highest mystical experience. You want to share some insights on that as well?
So as there are, see, these are my slides contained a list of those songs also, but again, paucity of time, I could not. So, Manasa Sancharare, Purna Bodhoham, Chinta Nastikila, खेलति मम हृदये सर्वं ब्रह्ममयम्. एक्चुअली दिस वर्स आई पर्सनली लव दिस कंपोजिशन. सर्वं ब्रह्ममयम् किं भोक्तव्यं किं अभोक्तव्यं. सो व्हाट टू ईट व्हाट नॉट टू ईट वेर टू गो एंड वेर नॉट टू गो. सो ऑल दोस कंसर्न्स डू नॉट रिमेन फॉर अ योगी who is established in his as in his pure conscious nature. As we saw from a quotation from the Atma Vidya Vilasa, he is free from those concerns. What should I do? What should I not do? What is appropriate? What is inappropriate? What will the other person? So all those things are transcended when we are purely established. So this particular verse, whenever it is, I hear them, gives the mere listening to the song gives a lot of bliss.
Very true. In fact, this is one common question that we come across in the field of yoga. When someone is deeply absorbed to the inner world, will they be dry to the outer world? But if you look at the compositions of Sadashiv Brahmendra, the beauty it evokes, the response it evokes, I think it's something highly mesmerizing in nature.
Yeah, I would like to add something here. Actually, these songs, how they came to be composed by Sadashiv Brahmendra. There is a very interesting anecdote there. As you rightly mentioned, will a yogi be dry to world outside when he is established in his pure bliss? Sadashiv Brahmendra, as I mentioned earlier, took a lifelong Maunavrata. So he decided not to speak. Then one of his classmates, Sridhara Ayyavaal, he was a grihastha, but again a great yogi himself. Being a grihastha, he was a great yogi. So once when Sadashiv Brahmendra and Sridhara Ayyavaal, they met, actually again life of Sridhara Ayyavaal is again a great inspiring thing, where by his yogic powers he brought Ganga to Kumbakonam in South India. So all those anecdotes are there. So Sridhara Ayyavaal, being a great jnani, he said, "Oh Sadashiva Brahmendra, I understand that you have a lifelong Maunavrata. Why not you need not use your words for worldly transaction. Why not compose verses or express your love for the divinity and the consciousness, pure consciousness, through your words? Why not employ your words in such a manner?" So when gently nudged by Sridhara Ayyavaal, then the spring of the pure bliss in the form of the compositions of Sadashiva Brahmendra emerged. Actually, he composed many, many hundreds of verses. We are left with only a few.
Okay. Just for the benefit of our participants, would you like to recommend where they can find them or how they can listen to them?
Actually, it is a trend in Carnatic music that they include one or two compositions of Sadashiva Brahmendra in their concert, wherever they do any Carnatic concert, one or two verses of Sadashiva Brahmendra will certainly be there. I don't specifically remember any particular source on the web. It is available. Compositions of Sadashiva Brahmendra. One beautiful rendering is by Balamurali Krishna on Sadashiva Brahmendra.
Thank you very much for that, Jairamanji. Now the connection with Sadashiva Brahmendra will become even more filled with life once they listen to the music, once they're able to connect. And they're also in very simple Sanskrit. Though it's in Sanskrit, it's an easily understandable Sanskrit. So that makes this whole experience very enjoyable. So thank you very much for that. I'll just take a couple of questions. We have quite a few questions here. You were speaking about the higher experiences and also gave reference to the life of Sadashiva Brahmendra. In your own observation or experience, have you come across such people even in these days, or somewhere that you can refer to, anything that you would want to mention about it, is a question from one of our participants this morning, from Dr. Jayaprakash Guptaji, I think, who joins us from Australia.
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. The point is, when we meet such people, we don't realize the people are such. For example, in our own institution, Krishnamacharya, Deshikachar, we consider them as such individuals. In our therapists, they themselves, they it is our firm kind of experience that when the therapy activity is happening, it is Krishnamacharya who is working through us in bringing about those changes. So such is the experience of influence of Sri Krishnamacharya. And even Deshikachar, when we see his life, is filled with such simplicity, such centeredness towards a higher purpose in life. So the point is, in the current, only a few like Ramana Maharshi and Sri Aurobindo, they manifest themselves to people around, whereas most others, they are what they are. As in the Upanishad we see, like sage Raikwa sitting under a dirty wooden cart and being immersed in the pure bliss. So in this way, there are so many people around us. It is we who have to refine our way of looking and trying to understand. So yeah, of course, this is a land of so many such siddhas. We train our perception, and there are even some may leave the next door also.
Thank you. You were referring to Ramana Maharshi. So we have a question. Next question related to that. If Sadashiva Brahmendra could overcome or solve some physical issues, when you were referring to the story where his limbs were cut off and such episodes, why did people like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa or Ramana Maharshi undergo the suffering at the physical bodily level in the end of their lives? Could they also have healed themselves? Any thoughts and comments on that? This question is from by Jayanti Adhishesh ji.
Yes. So, various such spiritual personalities, they exhibit various purposes. For example, it is, and I'm not sure whether how we can compare, or it may not be right to compare Sadashiva Brahmendra with Ramana Maharshi or Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Sadashiva Brahmendra lived and to exhibit to the world the greatest potentials of yoga, being a Jivan Mukta. Whereas Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa stayed closer to the householders, and he himself, though he was in pain, it is not right to put the word suffering. He certainly would not have undergone any suffering at all at the level of mind. So he probably accepted those physical discomforts just to show to his householder disciples around that these can be withstood and can be transcended. So the life and purpose of each and every yogi should be considered and studied in their own specific context. If we compare, we may not arrive, as we see in the current day research studies, we put in so many data, analyze and derive a generalization. But that is not possible in the life of these great yogis. They lived for various purposes, and they lived to exhibit various dimensions of possibilities of this consciousness, this potential to express itself in this world.
Just even to present it in the modern research methodology approach, this is all qualitative data. They cannot be grouped under the qualitative, quantitative manner, and statistics or an average cannot be done on that basis.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Jairam Manji. I'll just take up one last question. It's about, what is the need for the realized souls to cast off their bodies? Could they continue with their body if they have all that power, the capacity, and continue to help the world, heal the world, when the world needs such people and such masters?
This is a very interesting question, for which very truly, very honestly, I am also searching the answer.
Thank you very much. But we come
because
across
many times I have also wondered if they can transcend or if they have the Bhuta Jaya, Pradhana Jaya, why could they have not simply lived healed us? But there are references as to people who have lived for 200 and 300 years. Those records are there. But I still have the question. I share the same question with you and looking for the answer.
So I think our quest continues in this manner. With this, I really want to offer my gratitude to Jairamanji for taking the life of, I think this is just one example, taking the life of a realized soul, a yogin like Sadashiva Brahmendra, connecting with the Yoga Sutras, and also to present how such miracles or the so-called miracles or the experiences are possible, and also how to grow beyond them. I think all these things were covered in this particular presentation. We thank you very much for this. And I now would like to request you for two things. One, there are many requests that people also, our friends have shared. How can they contact you? Ramnathanji from Princeton has asked, is there any way that we can reach out to you? And there are many other friends also who have asked it. So when I make the announcements for the next session, maybe you can type it down and you can also mention when we come back to you. And also one message that you would want to share with all our participants, especially in the context of the kind of work you have been doing. There are very few people who are engaged in the textual studies, the research, and also connecting with the experiential world. I think you stand in a very unique area. And how would you like to invite people to join such a kind of a study or whatever you'd like to share? So I'll come back to you after making the announcements. Kotiji, can I request you for the posters of the day, please? So we just concluded a session with Jairamanji. In the noon, we have a practice session on Yoga Nidra with sound meditation by Aarti Padmanabhanji, who is a yoga teacher and also the founder of Padma Yoga Academy based out of Bangalore. In the evening, we have yet another teacher from Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, that is Srimati Nritya Jagannathanji, who is the director of KYM Institute of Yoga Studies. She will be speaking on Atha, the Yoga of Now. Atha is the very first word with which the Yoga Sutra begins. So she'll be focusing on that particular aspect, how it is the yoga of now and dealing with practical wisdom from a timeless text. So I invite you all to join us throughout for all these programs. I again want to remind, tomorrow evening, we have a session with Krishna Das, who is the internationally renowned name in the field of bhajans, kirtans and singing. So please join us for this bhakti immersion. And for the entire next week also, we have wonderful speakers coming up. All our programs are announced on Indica Yoga website. We have announced it up to Wednesday. And in the next couple of hours, we'll be announcing for the entire week as well. So do follow Indica Yoga website and get to know the events and the speakers who are coming in. And also, I want to let you know that all these videos are recorded, the sessions are recorded, and they are available on Indica Yoga YouTube channel. So please watch if you want to revisit. Many people were asking you about references to the books that were mentioned or some details to be repeated again. You can always visit the video once again and make the most of its what is made available to all of us. So watch on Indica Yoga YouTube channel, subscribe to them, and also share with those people who are really interested in getting to the authentic knowledge sources of the yoga tradition. So with this request, now I come back to Jairamanji for two things. One, how can people reach out to you and your message?
I'm just sharing my screen where you can see my email ID. Please let me know whether you can see the sure. Email ID. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
So these are the email IDs where you can write to me. This is actually a smaller J. So, and especially in the research, my research focus is the textual study of yoga. So where there is a unbroken continuity of commentaries to Yoga Sutras. That itself is a field where, which is not very much looked into. So right from Vyasa's commentary in the current date is given to Vyasa's commentaries around 4th century or even 3rd century. So till from 3rd century, there has been a continuous stream of commentaries on Yoga Sutras at various point of time. Be it Vijnana, Vachaspati Mishra's commentary in the 9th century, Bhoja's commentary in the 10th century, Vijnana Bhikshu in the 14th century, then Narayana Tirtha, Ramananda Yati in 17th, 18th centuries, and Sadashiva Brahmendra in the 18th century. Then even in 20th century, till 20th century, we have Hariharananda Aranya's commentary. So there is an unbroken continuity of commentaries at every stage of our history. We can see that a commentary has been composed. So the very historical study of the Yoga Sutra commentaries themselves will help how understanding of yoga has undergone a change, or how it was viewed in different points of time. Mm-hmm. So that we can, it will be, this study will be more useful, because in our current times, how do we understand Yoga Sutra? That will be more clearer as to how, when we see the historical kind of interpretations that Yoga Sutras have achieved in all these commentaries across ages. So from that sense, the relevance of Yoga Sutra can be better understood by looking into the commentary. So my work, I have limited my focus in the field of yoga to Yoga Sutras and the commentaries of Yoga Sutra, and making them more accessible to the student, research, teacher community, professional community. So Yoga Vaisharadi is one attempt where at least 14 commentaries are digitized, searchably digitized, and they can be transliterated into various scripts, be it Bengali or Tamil or Kannada. Not translation. Translation project is again a bigger project. And the point is critical edition. The very first thing that any Sanskrita text is, treatment that any Sanskrita text is accorded, is critical edition. Comparing various available manuscripts and arriving at a critical form, or how it could have appeared in the very origin. So that critical edition job has not yet been done for most of the Sanskrita commentaries. So beginning from that, which is called as lower criticism in literary textual research, higher criticism of the comparative contribution of that commentary to the field of yoga, all that remains to be done in a very great extent. So all who are interested in this exploration of textual study, especially centered on the Yoga Sutras, so they are welcome. Yeah, I'll be very happy to discuss and share my inputs and learn from them also.
So I have just shared the web link to the Vaisharadi page. It's okay. One of the wonderful web-based repositories that you can come across. It is searchable in nature. Most of the classical literature are made available in one place. I think all the students of yoga should make use of this resource available to us. So thank you, Jairamanji, and the entire team at KYM for presenting this, for putting together with all the efforts. I mean, I'm sure it would have taken a lot of efforts to bring it together like this. So thank you very much for the entire team.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
So with this, I thank all our participants who had joined us this morning, and look forward to seeing you again, once again in the noon. Namaste and pranams.
Namaste.